There's a psalm that I'd like to read before we go and take some time to pray. And I think it's really appropriate for this time that we're sharing here. Psalm 116. And it starts with verse 15. And it tells us about the heart of God in these moments. It says, "Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. O Lord, I am your servant. I am your servant and the son of your maidservant, and you have loosed my bonds. I will offer to you the sacrifice of thanksgiving and call on the name of the Lord." It's a neat picture. If you think about a parent, a dad, who knows that he has the absolute perfect gift for his son or his daughter, and he's been holding on to it for several months and waiting for Christmas or perhaps a birthday, and he has this anticipation that when he hands that gift to that child, it's going to be the most wonderful moment they've ever known. And when that time comes, whether it's Christmas or whether it's a birthday, the father hands that present to the child and just beams as the joy just sweeps over that child. That's what this idea of precious in the sight of the Lord means. God has been anticipating since the day he knew that Ralph Crump was going to trust Jesus as Savior to hand to Ralph every promise that Christ had made when Ralph went from death in this life into eternal presence with the Lord. God was just anticipating that moment when Ralph was going to step into heaven and everything that had been known by faith was now known in reality, and the face of the Christ who had died for him at the cross was the face that he saw beaming at him as he entered into eternity. And then for us, there is left the other verses. Be able to realize that yes, Ralph has now received that precious gift of eternal life in its fullness, and it is for us now to continue to be the servants of that God, to live with thanksgiving of heart as we enjoy the blessings he does give us in this life. And now, especially in moments like this, to call on that God for his grace and his comfort. And so that's what we're going to do now, is we're going to invite God to just fill this place with his presence and our lives with his comforting grace. Let's pray together. Father, we do indeed thank you for Christ. We thank you, Lord, for every great and precious promise that he has made to us. We thank you for the cross and for the payment of sin that took place there. And we thank you for the promise that Jesus has given to us, that all who believe in him indeed will not perish, but will have everlasting life. That death is not real, but it is simply a doorway to eternal life. Father, we pray for ourselves now, and Lord, together we gather around the family right now. We pray for them. And Lord, we ask that they will now know indeed your comfort and your encouragement, that they will experience in their hearts, Father, your hope. We give you this time. We ask you, Lord, to speak and to use it to our hearts. We pray all of this in the precious name of Jesus. Amen.
Far away stood an old rugged cross, the emblem of suffering and shame. And above that old cross were the dearest and best for a world of lost sinners must lay. So I'll cherish the old rugged till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. Oh, so despised by the world, has a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at rest I lay me down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown. To the old rugged cross I will ever be true, its shame and reproach gladly bear. Then you'll call me someday to my home far away, where his glory forever I'll share. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. I will cling to the old rugged cross and exchange it someday for a crown.
The Monday night before he died, Ralph was and his family were in the hospital room there at the memorial in Springfield. And we spent some time allowing the Bible to speak of the hope that we have in Jesus Christ and to speak of the hope that we have in God's love and his faithfulness and to speak of the hope that we have in the reality of heaven. So I'd like to read some of those scripture passages to you now. And I trust that the blessing that God delivered to the family and to Ralph on Monday night is the same blessing that you will receive now through his word. First is Psalm number 23. The Lord is my shepherd, and I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures, and he leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. And even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a place for me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint with oil. So follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Another passage that Ralph asked to hear is found in John chapter 14. The words of Jesus. Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, and believe also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way to where I am going. And Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? And Jesus said to him, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Recognizing that life can throw many challenges to us, God led Paul to write these words in Romans chapter 8. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is it to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died. More than that, who is raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed is interceding for us. And who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, or distress, or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, danger, or the sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who has loved us. For I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, or depth, or anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is ours in Christ Jesus our Lord. And then finally, the book of Revelation, God gives us just a little glimpse of heaven. Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. He will dwell with them, and they will be his people, and God himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain any more, for the former things have passed away. And he who was seated on the throne said, behold, I am making all things new. And also he said, write this down, for these words are trustworthy and true. And he said to me, it is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty I will give from the spring of the water of life without payment. Then the angel showed me the river of the water of life, bright as crystal, flowing from the throne of God and of the Lamb through the middle of the street of the city. Also on either side of the river, the tree of life with its 12 kinds of fruit, yielding each fruit each month. No longer will there be anything accursed, but the throne of God and of the Lamb will be in it, and his servants will worship him. They will see his face, and his name will be on their foreheads. And night will be no more. They will need no light of lamp or sun, for the Lord God will be their light, and they will reign together with him forever and forever. As we were talking with Ralph in the last couple of days that he was with us, there was nothing that meant more to him than the thought that he was going to go to heaven, and the thought that he was going to see Jesus. And as we read through those scriptures, you could just see in his face that the hope was real, and the reality of him anticipating the moment that he was going to see Christ was real. And so I trust that these scriptures that God's given to us for our comfort and our encouragement, our instruction, and our invitation will have given to you some real peace and some real comfort. We're going to talk a little bit more about heaven and what Ralph is experiencing a little later, but now Roger's going to come in and lead us in a congregational song.
Would invite you all to stand. We're going to sing Amazing Grace, so I'm going to need some help with this one.
Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, now in love, I was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious! has given the grace of now I first see the Lord has promised good to me. Word my hope secures, he filled my spirit for sin. As long as life
sharing in just a few moments. We're ready to go. Now, my first interaction with Ralph was a telephone conversation I had back in 2000, just prior to moving here from Pennsylvania to be the pastor of student ministries. He was a deacon of facilities and was coordinating a brand new office that was being created in the basement. I thought that was interesting. But anyway, he wanted to know how many bookshelves I needed. I love books. And so I said, well, give me a moment. I really don't know. And I got up from my desk and I paced off. I have two walls of books. And I paced off each wall, multiplied that by the number of shelves, came back to Ralph and said, I need this many feet of book space. And there was a stunned silence on the phone. And then he said, I never knew anyone that had that many books. Have you read them all? And I said, oh, no, I'd never read my books, but they sure look impressive when people walk into my office. It takes them, they assume that I'm highly intelligent, and it usually takes them at least 6 months to come to realize they were wrong, and I'm not. Ralph didn't miss a beat. He said, I doubt it will take us that long. And in that little exchange, I knew that I'd found a friend. It is rather fitting that the last thing Ralph said to me was in the hospital on Tuesday morning. And we were around the bed, and he was feeling hot, and Jan asked if I'd get a washcloth. And I took the washcloth, and I began to wipe his forehead and across his head, and I said, Ralph, does that feel better? And he said, yes, it does. And I said, well, I have a daughter who's a physician's assistant. And I said, well, if I need a second career, I can always give Sarah a run for her money and be a nurse. And he replied again, without missing a beat, you'll never get one over on her. She's way smarter than you. We purchased a fix-up house, and we moved to Bloomington, and Ralph was instrumental in getting us moved in. It took us 2 weeks just to move into the house. Remember the first day, we had ripped out every stitch of carpet that was in the place. All this 1970s paneling had gotten ripped out. We had floor molding ripped out, and I mean, we had 20 plus people, and I'm just watching stuff going out of my house. And Warren Schaefer, who's going to be sharing a little bit later, and actually Fred Martin, who's out there, it's Lori's husband, were out there, and they were like a couple of junior high Boy Scouts at a camp jamboree, because they had, we can burn in the county, and they had all this stuff at the burn pile. It just kept feeding this stuff to the fire. And I walked over to Ralph, who was looking out the sliding doors into the backyard at this scene, and we realized that there was a branch from a tree that went across the fire pit, and it was 20 feet above the ground, and it was burning. The flames were that high. And so Ralph looked at me and said, I think they're going to burn down your house. they looked around them at this totally gutted out house and said, maybe that would be better anyway. Then he shook his head and said, maybe not. Do you know where your hose is? Ralph was the one that showed me how to hang and finish drywall. He showed me how to replace windows. He showed me how to construct a wall. He showed me how to put up a ceiling. He showed me how to stipple. I didn't know any of that stuff. And Ralph would come over to the house over and over again, and he would spend a few hours with me and get me started and show me what to do. But the thing I really appreciated about Ralph was that he would say, okay, you know what you're doing? And I would nod, sort of, and he would say, okay, I'm going to go home. If you need something, call me. Because he didn't want to, as they say, just give me fish to eat, but he wanted to teach me to fish. And so he taught me how to do many things that I continue to be able to do today. He introduced me to woodworking and guided me in my first woodworking projects after we kind of got the house going, and allowed me to come down to his magnificent shop to be able to use his tools. And perhaps some of the best memories I have with Ralph are the hours we spent together in that shop. We spent hours discussing life, Bible verses, life mysteries, like our wives. And we laughed, and we were convinced that we had solved the world's problems. Ralph is a part of a Wednesday morning Bible study that we got started with five or six men. And we invited some other guys, and we got up to maybe six to eight guys. And for about 3 years, we got together, and we went deep into Scripture, but we also went deep into each other's lives. And as I think about those guys and I look around my life now, they are undoubtedly the closest friends that I continue to have here in Illinois. And that certainly included Ralph Crown. Ralph and I tried to keep in touch after he and Jan left Bloomington and left Grace Church, and we met six, seven, maybe eight times a year. Usually it was breakfast at Cracker Barrel, where I needed to find out that he needed to show me how to do something on a woodworking project, so I'd go to Hayworth and he'd show me something in the shop. Sometimes it had just been too long, and I would just say, hey, you doing anything this afternoon? I'd show up and we'd just have a cup of iced tea or a cup of coffee at the house and just chat. Whether it had been weeks or months, it was like we'd seen each other the day before, because that's just the kind of guy Ralph is. And I will truly miss him. And I look forward to seeing him on the other side. Two of the guys that were part of that Wednesday morning Bible study were Mike Parker and Warren Schaefer. And they're going to come up and they're going to share some things about Ralph now.
I don't know if I should say my name or not. Warren Schaefer, known as a pyromaniac now, I guess, anyway. I was in that small group with Ralph and Lynn, and it was a special time. We were in a group, Jan and I, with Jan and Ralph, and that was a special time. But I knew Ralph before I met him, it seems like. That might be sort of strange. I'll explain that a little bit, but as we're coming through the line, Brad was telling me he's got an image of his dad that's burned into his brain, and that's of his dad. Answering the phone the night before he died, and it wasn't that wimpy, hello, you know, it was Ralph, hello, you know, just that sassy Ralph. And I've got an image of of Ralph. In 1994, you two bought a house, Amy and Jeff bought a house out across the road from one of our farms, and I was up there farming. I didn't know these guys then, and I was up there farming, and there was two gentlemen out in the yard, and I'll never forget. They stopped what they were doing. It was a house that needed some work, tender loving care, and Ralph was good at that. And I'll never forget that face on that bright sunny morning. It looked just like that face right there. And I waved, and Ralph stopped, and he gave me his full undivided attention, the smile he had, that wave he had, and that's what's in my mind. And I thought, now there is a guy who has time for life, likes what he's doing, and he may like farmers, I don't know. So then I think it was 5 years later when you guys started coming to church, I met Ralph. I did not recognize that face, but I should have recognized that face as the one I saw in the yard, but I did not. But later on, we connected dots and figured out. And I did get to know Ralph, and I was right. He had time for life. He enjoyed what he's doing, and he liked farmers so much that he spent time at the Cracker Barrel for a number of years. So many years, in fact, that he got a plaque, I understand, from Cracker Barrel. I don't know what it said, the biggest nuisance, or I don't know what it was, but he got a plaque. And I said, Ralph, why do you spend time there at those farmers? The way I get it, they're just complainers and whiners. And he came back positive. No, he likes to see what they're going through and how they're doing it. And that was Ralph. It wasn't about Ralph. It was about other people. And we know that. You guys know that. You know, Timmy knows that. Ralph is about other people. And we went down to see him this fall when he started his fight with cancer. First things out of his mouth when I saw him was, how's your son Trevor doing? You know, he liked to watch Timmy beat Trevor up on their basketball games. And, you know, but he asked about that. And then I went back this spring when he was in his big fighting again still, and took him to a treatment. He came out of treatment, he was walking really slow, and he said, I'm so blessed. I said, what? He said, yeah, I don't have to have oxygen, I can walk. And thought, wow, that's Ralph. You know, that's Ralph. He had a hope. And it was my privilege to know Ralph, to work with Ralph, to pray with Ralph, to minister with Ralph, and finally to minister to Ralph, minister to him. So he's going to be missed, as Lynn said.
Well, he didn't want to miss his name, so that leaves me the last one. My name is Mike Parker. I met Ralph when he first came here. Actually, somebody told me there's a new guy here. He's pretty handy, they said. I said, okay, I'll let me figure that out. And I got the chance to meet him, and they were right. He was pretty handy. He was pretty good with the tools, the toys. I see you got a display out here. Jen, there's a nice display out there, some homemade wooden dozer, Caterpillar tractor, and a quarter cable driver. I thought that was pretty cool. Some various screws and nails laid there. That's Ralph. Those are Ralph's toys. And so anyway, we got a chance to meet, and we connected right away. We became friends, really good friends. And right away I found out the best way to find Ralph or get to connecting with him is meet him at Cracker Barrel. There's that Cracker Barrel thing going again. 6 o'clock every morning, it's that Cracker Barrel. Well, the only reason it was 6 o'clock, that's what time they opened. He'd have been there before that if they had opened at 5. He didn't sleep. He just slept a little bit, woke up. Had to do something, you know. Kind of like me, I got to be doing something. I don't sit around. Anyway, so we'd meet the Cracker Barrel, and he'd have the same thing every morning. He wouldn't have to tell the waitress what he wanted. They just bring it to him. I think if he didn't show up that one day, they'd have us sitting on the table and he'd be sitting there waiting on him. The country morning, scrambled eggs, grits, sawmill gravy, and the biscuit, and sweet iced tea. Real sweet iced tea. So we got to be real good friends, but we also had made a kind of a pact when we do things around here. We said, we're going to have fun. There's times he would just crack me up. I can't remember some of the things they were, but I know we laughed a lot while we worked. His handiwork is throughout this church. There's things here that he's done and we did together that you know, he knew how to do it. He was handy. We also had a spiritual connection. Like Lynn and Warren said, we were in a small group Bible study together, and we learned a lot. We went real deep in the Word and studied the Word, and we had a spiritual connection. We were brothers. And family, you've lost a loved one today, and I've lost a friend. I've lost a good friend. And it's an honor to be here to be asked to share some things with you today. So God bless each one of you.
The family has written down a few things that they would like me to read in regards to their thoughts about their husband and their dad and their grandfather. And the first one is from Jan. As I reflect on Ralph's life, I have many great memories. Being married for 43 years, I should have known when I flew to Okinawa that our life together would be an exciting and unpredictable wild ride. With all of our memories, where do I begin? Let's see. Ralph helped me celebrate my 16th birthday. Ralph and the kids would always end up wrestling in the kitchen while I was making dinner. We attended a lot of ball games. Ralph loved serving God, whether it was mowing the church lawn, painting, or enjoying the men's fellowship. Ralph's health issues over the years has always shown us how to lean on and trust in God when we didn't know what to do. Ralph's faith sustained us as we discussed how God takes care of the birds and he would take care of us too. Ralph was a brave and courageous man. I'm thankful for his life and for his love for me and our family. I'm glad that Ralph is no longer in pain. Over the last couple of months, I've actually been enjoying filling his bird feeders, and everywhere I look, I see American flags and red knockout roses. Hugs and kisses. I love you, Ralph. P.S. Yes, the bird feeders are full. From Brad. My dad made me a better man. He taught me to be true to my word and to treat others how I wanted them to treat me. He was respected by everyone that knew him. I remember when I was 16 and I blew up the engine of my first truck. Instead of getting mad, he turned it into an opportunity to teach me a life lesson on how to fix vehicles. When I was in my 20s, he gave me space to find myself and didn't judge the decisions I made. He was always there to ask me how I was and if I needed anything. When I had children, I realized being a parent is very hard. You want the best for your children, but they don't always make the right decisions, and sometimes you have to allow them to fail in order for them to learn how to succeed. The last conversation I had with my dad, we talked about life, love, and family. He said he was proud of me and my family. He was sad that he wouldn't be there to watch Bruno and Brody grow up. I told him that it was okay because he would have the best seat in the house and wouldn't ever miss another game. I will miss my dad, but I know he went home and isn't in pain anymore. He will be missed, but he will never be forgotten. From Angie. I remember when Timmy was starting to climb out of his crib, I kept trying to teach him that he shouldn't try to climb out. Dad was babysitting one day, and when I came home, Tim had just been waking up from a nap. Dad told me to go in and watch Tim, because Dad had taught Tim how to climb out of the crib. Dad said, well, if Tim's going to do it, that Dad had better teach him how to do it right and safe, so that Tim didn't get hurt. That was my father's way of doing things. Even though I didn't want to teach Tim that, Grandpa decided that I was overruled. This is one of the first things I was overruled on, and it surely was not going to be the last. I've watched my father make an impact in so many lives, not just within the family, but with every person that he has touched. From Tim. I remember everything about my grandpa. I remember all of the laughs we shared, all the time we spent together. So when I was asked to write down memories, my mind went blank. I thought to myself, I have no idea where to start. Ever since I can remember, my grandpa's been there with a welcoming heart and open arms. It's crazy to think that he's gone and that there are no more memories to be made. But I look back and reflect on all those wonderful days that we did have. I was truly blessed to have a grandfather so great and active in my life. When it comes to my grandfather, one thing is for certain. He is a one-of-a-kind man. I feel like no matter what I say, it won't be enough to convey what I truly feel. So well, I will end it with this. Grandpa, you meant so much to me, and I will miss you dearly. I will strive every day to do my best and be the man you raised me to be, and a daily reminder to others of the man that you once were. You will be forever in my heart, Papa. And from Wyatt. On cool summer mornings, this wonderful man would always want to take me to go out fishing with him. This man would come to my house and pick me up in his sharp red Chevy Silverado with 24 juicy fat worms ready to be drowned in the pond. On the way to our secret fishing spot, we would hit up a spot that he had gone to for years. He took his kids and his grandchildren to go eat. The place was known as Cracker Barrel. To go eat their amazing breakfast, which contained biscuits and gravy, and which he would always get. After the fulfilling breakfast, he would take me out to the pond and catch bluegill off the bank. On this one particular morning, we ended up catching 201 bluegills in less than 2 hours. The reason we only fished for 2 hours was because a storm was about to roll in, and he said fish wouldn't bite when it started to rain. And he had a reason behind that. He would say that whenever it rains, fish don't want to come out and bite your bait because the fish are afraid to get wet. That joke will forever be with me, and I hope to tell my kids that. That man spent a lot of time with me and made a lot of efforts to do so. And that man was my grandpa. And I'm going to miss him and getting to spend time with him. And I appreciate all the time that we got to spend together. From Shelby. On my wall in my bedroom hangs a shelf. An arrangement of books rest on top along with the frame that contains my confirmation verse. This bookshelf has proudly stood strong for countless years. I never fear that pressure and age will make her fall. My grandpa built this shelf for me by hand. Every inch was smoothed out with studious concentration. Every bend of the wood a showcase of his talent for woodworking. When I gaze upon the bookshelf, I am rewarded with the image of him. I can hear his laugh bellowing out of him, cracking a smile out of everyone in the room, and even the smile of pride he would willingly award to you if you scored a touchdown or made a basket. I do not recall the man who was sitting in a hospital bed, but the man who was adamant that he was the only one to pass out Christmas presents. He was like the books on my shelf, telling all of us great stories and keeping us thoroughly entertained. Grandpa was as strong as the mahogany wood he had used to build my shelf. For as long as I can remember, he was always in some form of pain, yet he was always there for people, whether it was a football game or an awards ceremony. Most importantly, he was a man of great faith. The last moments I had with Grandpa were when we were in his hospital room listening to readings from Revelation. The way he smiled while listening to what awaits us in heaven was beautiful. A peace settled over him, knowing that he would meet Jesus and walk alongside of him soon. There will be events in the future where his presence will be deeply missed, such as high school graduations and college graduations, birthdays, and even watching us grandkids marry the love of our lives. In these moments, we must remember that even though he will not be there in person, he will look down upon all of us with love from a place where he is no longer in pain. Let us not mourn his loss, but instead be cheerful, knowing how many lives he has touched and the love that he leaves us with. And then a poem that was given to me by his daughter, Angie. I will never say goodbye to you, my father, because I know this is not the end for us to see each other. You will only be going to a place where there's no pain nor suffering. I'm happy for you will be with God. For now, we need to go in separate ways. I remember how your arms hold me and give me strength. You were always there to listen, love, and defend me in everything. You were my very best friend. In my triumphs, you were always proud. I'm very grateful and proud to call you my dad. Here deep inside my heart, you'll always be. I would give up everything I have just to hug you one more time. I remember the last time I held your hand and how you looked at me in the eyes. If only I could turn back the time, I would have never let you go. I felt the world stop and my heart stop beating when they told me that you were gone. How I wish I was only dreaming. Just like the rain, tears fell down from my eyes and I couldn't speak for a while. Thank you, Dad, for always understanding, listening, caring, and loving me your whole life. The greatest gift God gave me was you, my dad. It's difficult to let you go, but I must. I must return the gift God gave to me. Until then, see you in heaven.
Would invite you again to stand. We're going to sing How Great Is Our God.
A few years ago, I was eating breakfast with Ralph, and he asked me if I'd ever read the book entitled Heaven by a man by the name of Randy Alcorn. And I told him, yes, I have. And I said, well, what did you think of the book? And Ralph said, man, I loved it. And he looked at me in the eye, and he said, I have a question for you. Why don't you preachers tell us more about heaven. Because I have no idea what it's going to be there, but I do know this, I can hardly wait to get there. Heaven, the place, not the book, became a regular part of almost every conversation I've had with Ralph for the last 3 years. Right up to our last one, real conversation this past Monday. And so we're going to take a few minutes, and just a few minutes here, to answer this one question. Ralph Crump died on June 18th at 7:43 p.m. What was Ralph doing at 7:44? What was Ralph experiencing at 7:44? And where was Ralph experiencing it? Revelation chapter 4 that we're going to look at here is one of my favorite portions of Scripture, because if I understand the context of this chapter, this scene is taking place right now. It is a scene taken in heaven in the current time. And it's taking place in this current time right up until Jesus Christ returns to establish his kingdom. And if that is correct, if that is indeed the interpretation of this chapter, as I read these verses, Ralph is now embedded into this scene. He is there. And he is experiencing everything that I'm about to read. And I'd like to walk us just briefly through these verses. John, the Apostle John, has been having a vision from Christ about the end times. And so he gets to chapter 4 and he says this. After this, or at this point in time, in this interaction he's having with God, I looked and behold a door standing open in heaven. And the first voice which I heard speaking to me like a trumpet said, come up here and I will show you what must take place after this. At once I was in the spirit and behold a throne stood in heaven with one seated on the throne. And he who sat there had the appearance of jasper and carnelian. And around the throne was a rainbow that had the appearance of an emerald. You know, what we're looking at art that's not meant to be an actual photograph or an actual picture, but it's a more abstract art. In other words, John's just trying to get us to understand that there's this appearance of Christ. In fact, the thing that we notice as we come here is the first thing John sees is Jesus. It is Christ. With everything else that we're going to see going on, his focus is right on the fact that he sees Christ. And these are two emeralds that when light flashes on them are incredibly bright and multicolored. And the idea is that this Jesus that is on this throne is not the lowly carpenter who had walked the face of the earth for 33 years, but this is the Christ who is God the Son, and he has now returned to his full glory as God. There is an emerald rainbow that goes across the throne, and that is just wonderful because in Scripture, the rainbow was given to us back in Genesis at the time of the flood as a symbol of God's promises to mankind. And so this great Lord, who is in all of his glory as the second person of the Godhead, is also surrounded by the reminder that this Christ has made promises that he's going to keep. So that's the first thing that John sees. The next thing that he sees are all of those who have died with saving faith in Christ and are now in his presence. Verse 4 says, around the throne were 24 thrones, and seated on the thrones were 24 elders, clothed in white garments with golden crowns on their heads. The idea of the 24 elders represents all Christians that have died and are now in the presence of God. And so there's Jesus, and he's surrounded by all those who've placed faith in him over the last 20 centuries. The next thing that John sees are the angels that surround the throne. It says, on each side of the throne were four living creatures full of eyes in front and behind, and he goes on to describe them, but what he describes are angels. And the fact that even between Christ and his people are the angels that are constantly around his throne, worshiping him and doing his bidding. So this vision of heaven, of a glorified Jesus, of millions of people who have placed faith in Him over the centuries, of angels that are just calling out in worship and service to this Christ. And then John sees and hears incredible worship. He hears, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. Worthy are You, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for You created all things, and by Your will they existed and were created." And so at 7:44 on Tuesday evening, there are a lot of things that Ralph experienced, but there's four that come out of this passage. The first thing that Ralph experienced and saw was he saw the face of Jesus. It was the last thing he was talking about before he passed from this life, and it's the first face he saw when he passed on into the next. The scripture says, "No longer will there be anything accursed, but the throne of God and of the Lamb, that is of Christ, will be in heaven, and His servants will worship Him, and they will see His face." They will see Him and be just absolutely closely united with Him. Ralph has experienced that. Ralph is now in the presence of God. In 2 Corinthians, Paul gives us these verses. He says, "So we are always of good courage. We know that while we are at home in the body, we are away from the Lord. For we walk by faith and not by sight. Yes, we are of good courage, and we would rather be away from the body and at home with the Lord." Paul is saying, you know, while we're living in this body, we cannot be in the actual presence of God. The presence of God is with us, but we're not in His presence in heaven. But the moment we leave this body, we are with Him. And Ralph is enjoying the very presence of the living God. Third thing that happened immediately was Ralph was free from every pain and sorrow. "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth," as we read earlier. "For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bridge adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Behold, the dwelling place of God is with man, and He will dwell with them, and they will be His people, and God Himself will be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death shall be no more. Neither shall there be mourning, nor crying, nor pain, for the former things have passed away.'" There's a time in which all of creation is going to be redeemed, but Ralph has experienced that freedom now in the place where he is. And he is meeting and worshiping with every follower of Christ, those millions of believers. From the apostles of the first century, he has met the Apostle Peter. He has met the Apostle Paul. And undoubtedly, he's met several Marys as well. But every believer through the last 20 centuries is there. Ralph has joined him. And Ralph has joined him. A number of years ago, our small group, of which Ralph and Jan were a part, went and did a ministry at a little coffee house downtown that ministers to people that are in some pretty dire straits. And Ralph gave his testimony. I'm so glad that that took place. It's probably the most complete and clearest testimony I've heard Ralph give of when he came to know Christ as Savior. Crystal clear. See, Jesus had invited Ralph to place saving faith in Him, and Ralph has said yes. And it's the invitation that we saw as we opened up this chapter where it says, "A door was standing open to heaven, and the first voice which I heard speaking to me like a trumpet said, 'Come up here.'" There is a door, there is a voice, and there is an invitation. The door is Jesus Christ Himself, because He is the only one through whom we can come into a right relationship with God, and the only one through whom we can spend eternity in God's presence, based on what He did for us at the cross. And verses again we read earlier, Jesus says, I am the way, and I am the truth, and I am the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. The voice that calls out to the Apostle John is the same voice that called to Ralph, and it's the same one that is called into our lives. It's the voice of Jesus himself. And what he says is the same thing that he said back in the first century to John. Come to me. Come to me. He said this back in the Gospel of Matthew. He says, come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. This past Tuesday, at 7:43, Jesus Christ spoke into Ralph's life and said, Ralph, it's time. The door is open, and the personal voice of Jesus beckoned to the soul of Ralph and then welcomed him into the glories of heaven. And Ralph has entered into this picture in Revelation 4, where there is joy and where there is this worship. That's unbelievable. May you find comfort where Ralph found his comfort. May you find hope where Ralph found his hope, and that is in Jesus. May you look into your own life and heart to see if you, like Ralph, have placed saving faith in Christ at some point in your life, so that you can join Ralph in the picture of heaven that has been painted here. There are many members of the family that I know would be willing to share that testimony with you, as would I. It's a great picture, isn't it? The face of Jesus, presence of God, the absence of pain, worshiping at his throne. All pain gone, every evidence of sin taken away, and the perfect relationship we were created to enjoy with God is ours because of what Jesus has done for us at the cross. Let's pray. Father, indeed, we thank you for Christ. We thank you for hope. We thank you, Lord, for the cross. We thank you for forgiveness from sin. We thank you for Jesus saying, come to me. I pray, God, that each one here would weigh in their hearts whether that time has come in their life where they have recognized their need of a Savior, have turned to Christ, and have said, Lord Jesus, I believe that you have indeed died for my sins. I ask you now to come into my life as my Savior. Thank you that Ralph did that, Lord. And I thank you that it then became the defining part of his life. We thank you, Lord, for Ralph. We thank you for the impact that he had on our lives, for the friendship he offered, for the love that he gave. We thank you that he now is in your presence. And we now, Father, we walk on. May those who knew him best and closest, Lord, know your mercy and your comfort and your encouragement in the days ahead. Lord, we give you ourselves in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you.
Lord.